Hey everyone, Mark here from the Angular team at Google, and I am thrilled to have you join this course on the fundamentals of Angular. Now, whether you are new to the framework or coming back after some time away, there has never been a better time to learn Angular. In this course, you'll learn about components, routing, dependency injection, and so much more. You'll even get experience with modern Angular features like Angular signals and deferrable views. Take this course and learn everything that you need to build your first Angular app and be set on the road towards building the next great app that your users will love. Displaying dynamic values in components. Let's talk about that, because that is a core part. Because right now we have static data. We can have whatever we just want to write, but we can do better. Let's take our component. Let's say this is app.component.html, okay? This is not the best user experience. What if you signed into your banking app and it was like, welcome user? You're like, this is a scam. Like, this is not a real banking app. Like, this is fraud. Okay, because what you probably want to do is change that. You want to go from user to something actually like real there. Okay, here's how you do it. In our component class, you get to define class properties, okay? So now we got username equals coding temp. That's the username. Now, here's what's super interesting. Remember I said that, wait, can you tell me what components are written in? What language do we use?
TypeScript.
TypeScript, but we don't see any types here. Why is that? Why don't we see any types? So this is a nice feature of TypeScript. TypeScript is really, 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 really smart. Microsoft team, shout out to you for this. Wow, that's for you. Okay. This is able to infer that coding temp is a string, so I don't have to explicitly put the type. So type inference in TypeScript is really natural and very, very good, right? It can infer every single type, of course, but especially things like primitives, it'll know, right? And if your type signatures are set up properly from like functions that return things, it'll be able to do type inference and know what type it is, so you don't have to write the type there. But I could write the type there. I could do that if I wanted to. Okay, so now we have our property, username. But we want to go back into our template. How do we link the username to our template? Well, here's how you do that. All right, so how do we make it work? Well, you use double curly braces, right? The double curlies. That's what we call string interpolation. Okay, so in your template, you use double curlies. I think in React, it's only single curlies, right? Is that right? Yeah, okay, so, you know. Gotta be different, why not? All right, so we use double curlies here, okay? And then inside the double curlies, what can go there? What are the valid values? Expressions are the valid values, right? So it can be like a string, you know, is a valid value there, right? Because it evaluates just being a string. Or you could put like a calculation. If you did like 1 + 1, the expression results into something that can go there, okay? So now with our interpolation, we can put our username, but that username links back to our component. So we got a price in there. Price looks good. This bonus offer is only $30. You got to jump on this. Now let's jump into the next thing. What do I type here?
Curly braces, item.name.
Perfect. Double curly braces. We do item, or that was not item, item.name. But you see how it's giving me IntelliSense in the template? That's where the Angular language service comes into play. Right, is that it can know in a string that we're doing Angular code, okay? And then, here's another value there. Then I can also do things like, if I'm holding down the command key on my keyboard, and then I could like command click and go right down to where that property is defined. So the Angular language service really changes your like developer experience there. All right, and then let's get to our description. And let's see how we're doing here. And we'll do item.description. Okay, fantastic, friends. Yeah. And then if we go back, here's our product. So to make this work, we got to enable routing. So let's do that. Let's enable routing. And I want to do this one with you again, so we can keep our pace up just a little bit, because we still have some more things I want to get through. And I want to make sure that we don't have to skip stuff. Okay. I know this might be a little tricky because you just learned it. Where do we start with the routes? Anybody remember?
In app.routes?
Let's try there. That sounds good to me. Aha! Look at you! What is you in here doing with all these good answers? Let's start there. Let's add a route. It says add the default path. What do you think the default path is? This, you could just guess. I don't know. I didn't tell you, so you can just guess if you like.
Empty string?
Empty string. Good guess. Yeah, empty string. Mm-hmm. So we say path, empty string. Now, where do I want to go?
Greetings.
I sure do. Greetings component. Nailed it. Okay. Path. And then we go to our component. Just to kind of show you what some of the other things you can do too with routing. So remember I was telling you about like the, how you get that out of there? Let's see. I mean, you got so many things you can do with your routes. You got route guards, you can set the title. Something that's really interesting, it's like load component and load children. It's how you can do lazy loading of routes. Lazy loading is where you don't ship all of the code for a route unless it's needed. And so your bundles are smaller, right? So you can even do stuff like that at the router level. Very nice APIs for that stuff. Okay, let's keep going. All right, so the next step, so we already enabled it in app.routes, and go to app.config, and let's provide our router. So let's make that happen. So this is a two-parter. So first thing is, in this providers array, the first thing I want to provide is provide router. Okay, it needs a okay. I got a function, but it's complaining. Anybody know how I can figure out what it wants? How can I figure it out? If I highlight it, it'll tell me what it's looking for. An argument for routes was not provided, so I got to give an argument for routes. What should be my argument for routes?
Routes.
Yeah, routes. Mm-hmm. Good, 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 good. We're on one. Look at that. Bam! Let's see if it's working. Still not working. Unbelievable. You skipped a step. Okay, one more. Well, three, well, two more steps. Okay. Now in app.component, we got to get our router module and we got to do router outlet. We got to do both of those things. Import it and then use it. So let's get this party all the way started. So let's go back to our 07 source app. I'm switching over to app.component. Okay, first thing, imports. Let's do route, oh, come on, IntelliSense, stop helping me for a second. Router module. Okay, we got that part. So I imported it by just typing it, I let it help me. So on line 3, it helped me, router module there. Feels good. And then I had to import it so my component could use my component, not opponent, so my opponent could use it. No, so my component can use it. And then I do router outlet. And we could do self-closing. Now I'm gonna save this. And then I'm going to, oh, look at that nice message. You can tell it's for me. Now, when you ever done lazy loading before, you may have done it with some like fancy configuration at your router level, where you take parts of your application and then you say, don't ship this part, don't ship this route. What if I told you that with deferrable views, you can take parts of your component, the template, and say, don't ship this line, don't ship this part of the component until something meaningful happens? And what if I told you do all that work in the template? Well, I said it was special. Let me show you what I mean. Check out this template. Okay, this is a template. I want to load the recommended movies component only if someone interacts with the trigger. Check this out. So you use the @defer syntax. So this is saying defer the loading of whatever's in my curly braces, defer that loading until the interaction happens. What's my interaction says trigger? What is that trigger? Okay, now we're really cooking. Because this trigger is what's called a template variable in Angular. So you can just like say, hey, I want a reference to this button. Okay, # and give it a name and then you get a reference to the element. It works on any element. It's just a thing you can do in Angular. I know, pretty cool. All right, So if someone interacts with the trigger, then what happens? The recommended movies load. When I say load, I don't mean it appears on the screen. I mean the request for the data for the actual packets happens. Because it is not shipped with your code, you see? Just stick with me. I know. Friends at home, I know some of y'all are just having to wear a hat so your brain doesn't blank blog. It's like, oh my God. Okay, just stick with me. When I'm waiting for it to load, because it has to make the HTTP request again, right, for that code, I can set a loading screen. Whatever I want it to be. Whatever I want this to be. Any HTML, any component. Something goes wrong, I have an error that I can show as well. And while I'm loading it, while it is in flight, I can also show something. This is all in the template. There is no special backend coding. There is nothing fancy that I've done. This is all in the template level. But we're gonna demonstrate this. Don't you worry. Well, some of y'all are like, man, that seems good, Mark, but what if I wanted to do custom things? Like, I wanna make my own triggers. Fine. When the count or some arbitrary expression that can be defined as truthy or falsy, right, happens, load it then. So that means that count came from where? That's from my application class. So that means it's programmatic at that point. That's, we're cooking. We are, I smell that so good. Look it. So there are a whole bunch of triggers. When the browser sends the idle message, that's the thing the browser can do. I can load some components then. Or I can do it immediately, right? Once the other stuff is rendered, I'm sorry, once this thing gets rendered on the screen, because you know how browsers render, right? Once it hits this one, okay, fine. You know, then start the fetching. But don't fetch it before that. Okay, wait some time. Maybe I know that our service at work is a little slow because it's like a legacy service written in COBOL, and it takes like, you know, a little bit of time. I don't want to call it yet. Fine, give it some time. Say 1 minute, 2 seconds, whatever. Put your time in there. Or maybe I don't want it to happen until you scroll the page and then something enters the viewport. Then I'll load it, because they never scroll down. Why would I load the component? Why load 150 comments if they're never going to look at it? I know. Or then you saw the interaction. Like, that's like a click, right? You can do that. Or let's say you hover over an area of your screen that you can define. You can go even further. So there's a difference between like lazy loading and prefetching and displaying. So lazy load, you can just do this whole thing where you're like, all right, when it's time to load it, then display. Or what you can do is say, you know what? Start getting it, but I'm not ready for you to show it yet. But start getting it at my condition, whatever my condition is. So then I can say, load on interaction, or if they haven't interacted yet, but the browser has been done with everything else, start prefetching the code. You know, get started, get a head start. Or a custom trigger. Man, look at this page. This looks amazing. But it's a whole bunch of, this came from the internet, right? Meaning like I made an HTTP request. Just so you can see it, let's do the network. I'm gonna reload this page. Let's see, close that out. Can I reload? All right, I did reload. Oh, that's why I got that word chunk in there. I'm like, what? See, posts came from the internet. So that's not like local. So this page, depending on the traffic to the site, could be super slow, right? To load a bunch of posts, could be super slow. What could we do? We want to defer the loading until we're ready to do it. And the way I want to do it is when you interact with this button, then I want to load it. So let's do that. All right, so let's get cooking. So I'm going to go into app.component.ts. Okay. Now, it's a lot of work to set this up because I want to dynamically load this code, not defer the loading of the call. I'm saying I don't even want to ship the app post code. I don't even want it to be shipped to the browser until I request it. Okay, let's see if I can do it. Oh, do I got enough time for this? Oh, so much. I don't know. Let me just try. Oh, I'm so stressed. It's so much to write. Oh man, what's going on? Does that thing, okay, I need a trigger. Oh, I need a trigger. Okay, I'm done. that's the whole thing. Now, that's a pretty advanced scenario that I described to you. Let me show you how it works. Okay, so this is everything that came. We got a couple of chunks that came, platform browser. We got, I don't see any data. Wait, it was called posts. No data for posts. Now check this out. So I'm gonna clear this, not refresh, clear it. I'm gonna click load posts. Look at the order of operation. Look at the order of operation. First, the chunk of code came. Okay? Then the library that Angular needed to make our code work. Then what happened third? The data request happened third. So that's evidence to you that we did not ship this code, right? It did not go to with the initial browser bundle, which is really, really special. So here's our data, just proof. Okay, cool. Here's our chunk. Wait a minute. This is like the code that gets written by our compiler, you know, as it compiles it so it can be optimized. So it won't look identical, but you can see it's our post component. You see, I'm not lying about that, right? Ah! there's our fetch call to go get our data. So now, that's why I said this is earlier on, because I know that optimizations are kind of tricky because people are really worried about like pre-optimizing. This isn't really pre-optimizing. This is just making your app better, right? You just throw that defer on there. It didn't cost you anything. I didn't set up any configuration. I didn't do nothing. I just typed defer. And I think this is a really good idea. And I do think that we'll see even more adoption of this pattern where you can just block out parts of your application. Just choose any part you want and just start wrapping in defer. Just start having a good old time.